JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's weekly market outlook webinar for the week June the 8th until June the 12th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer first. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, what are the important developments and events for this week? The most important one is the FOMC decision on Wednesday. We get Norway's CPIs the same day, the US CPIs the same day, Sweden CPIs on Thursday, while on Friday we have the UK monthly GDP for April and an EU finance minister's meeting. So, the financial world continued trading in a risk-on mode in the end of last week, with a positive morale rolling somewhat into the Asian session today. You can see that major EU and US indices closed in positive territory, while today Nikkei gained 1.25%, while Shanghai's composite is up 0.12%. Now, with regards to this week's events, on Monday appears to be a relatively light day in terms of data. We already got Japan's GDP, final GDP for the first quarter, which was revised higher to -0.6% from -0.9%. Later in the day, the only releases worth mentioning are Germany's industrial production for April, as well as Canada's housing starts for May and building permits for April. Germany's industrial production is expected to have tumbled 16% month over month after sliding 9.2% in March, while Canada's housing starts are forecast to have declined to 150,000 from 166,400. No forecast is available for the nation's building permits. Now on Tuesday during the Asian morning, we have New Zealand's ANZ and Australia's NAB business confidence indices for May, but neither is accompanied with a forecast. During the European morning, Germany's trade balance for April, Eurozone's final GDP for the first quarter, and the bloc's employment change for the quarter are due to be released. The German trade surplus is forecast to have declined to 10.2 billion euros from 12.8 billion, while Eurozone's final GDP is just expected to confirm its preliminary estimate, namely that the euro area economy shrank 3.8% quarter over quarter during the first 3 months of 2020. The bloc's employment change is expected to show that the euro area economy has lost 0.2% jobs after gaining 0.3% in the last quarter of 2019. Later from the US, we get the JOLTS job openings for April, which are expected to have slid to 5.75 million from 6.191 million in March. Now, on Wednesday, all lights are likely to fall on the FOMC decision, the first after April, when the committee kept interest rates unchanged at the 0 to 0.25% range and hinted that more stimulus may be delivered if judged necessary. We will continue to use powers proactively until we are confident that the US is solidly on the road to recovery, Fed Chair Powell noted. He also added that economic activity will likely drop at an unprecedented pace in the second quarter, which suggests that they were more willing to act again than not. However, we don't expect them to act at this gathering yes, the Atlanta Fed GDP now and the New York now cast models add credence to Powell's remarks, pointing to a minus 53.8% and minus 25.5% growth rates, respectively. But until we get official numbers, we don't believe that the Fed will rush into expanding its stimulus efforts. After all, they already announced an expansion of their municipal liquidity facility on Friday. Another factor which makes us believe that the Fed is unlikely to act this time is the much better than expected employment report for May. On Friday, the report showed that the US economy added 2.51 million jobs instead of losing 8 million, as the forecast suggested, with the unemployment rate falling to 13.3% from 14.9%, beating estimates of a surge to 19.7%. Now, given that this will be on one of the bigger meetings, which are accompanied by economic projections, it would be interesting to see what the current view among officials in the wake of such a surprising jobs report is. In our view, the report suggests that the worst with regards to the coronavirus is behind us, but it remains to be seen whether officials will share that view as well. Although we don't expect them to act, we believe that they will stay ready to do so if things fall out of orbit, which combined with a relatively not that worrisome language over the economic outlook may allow equities and risk-linked assets to continue drifting north as investors abandon safe havens. Now, as for Wednesday's data, during the Asian morning, we have Australia's Westpac Consumer Sentiment Index for June, for which there is no forecast available. China's CPI and PPI rates are also coming out. The CPI is forecast to have slowed to 2.6% year over year from 3.3%, while the PPI rate is anticipated to have fallen further into the negative territory to minus 3.3% year over year from minus 3.1%. Now, during the early EU morning, Norway's CPIs for May are coming out. The headline CPI rate is anticipated to have risen to 1.2% year over year from 0.8%, while the core rate is forecast to have ticked up to 2.9% from 2.8%. At its latest meeting, the Norges Bank cut its benchmark policy rate to 0%, with officials saying that it will most likely stay at that level for some time. We do not envisage making further policy rate cuts, Governor Olsen said in the accompanying statement. Thus, accelerating inflation may add credence to officials' view and may allow them to sit comfortably on the sidelines. We get more CPI data for May from later in the day from the US. The headline rate is expected to have ticked down to 0.2% from 0.3%, while the core rate is forecast to have slid to 1.3% year over year from 1.4%. Despite a potential slowdown in US inflation, we don't expect market participants to pay so much attention. And the reason is because we expect them to keep their gaze locked on the FOMC decision, which is due to be released later in the day. Now on Thursday, EU trading time, Sweden's inflation numbers for May are due to be released. Both the CPI and CPIF rates are forecast to have remained unchanged at minus 0.4% year over year, but as it is always the case, we prefer to pay more attention to the core CPIF rate, which excludes energy. That rate slid to 1% in April from 1.5% in March. When they last met, Riksbank policymakers decided to continue purchases of government and mortgage bonds up to the end of September 2020 and to leave the repo rate unchanged at 0%. They also said that the measures will be adjusted to economic developments. Thus, a potential rebound in the core CPIF metric may raise some speculation that the world's oldest central bank may start scaling back its QE at some point soon. From the US, we get the PPIs for May. The headline rate is forecast to have declined to minus 1.3% year over year from minus 1.2%, while the core rate is anticipated to have slid to plus 0.4% year over year from plus 0.6%. Finally, on Friday, During the Asian morning, Japan's final industrial production for April is due to be released, with the forecast expected to confirm the preliminary print of -9.1% month over month. Now, later in the day, the UK's monthly GDP, industrial production, and the nation's trade balance, or for April, are due to be released. Economic activity is forecast to have tumbled 18.7% month over month after sliding 5.8%, something that will drive the year-over-year rate down to -22.3% from -5.7%. Industrial production is also expected to have accelerated its decline to -15% from -4.2%, while the nation's trade deficit is expected to have narrowed to £11.54 billion from £12.51 billion. Now, although this data may increase the chances for the introduction of negative interest rates by the Bank of England, we believe that GBP traders may stay on the edge of their seats in anticipation of fresh headlines with regards to Brexit. On Friday, EU and UK negotiators said that they have made very little progress in their latest round of talks, and with just a few days left for the UK to ask for an extension to the transition period, headlines on that front may carry extra weight as we get closer to the June 18th and 19th EU summit. UK Prime Minister Johnson has been insisting on a December 31st deadline for finding common ground, while EU Chief Negotiator Barnier noted that a deal needs to be sealed by the end of October, in order to allow enough time for ratification by the bloc's 27 member states. Thus, anything pointing to further disagreement could strengthen the case for a no-deal Brexit at the end of this year and may add pressure to the British pound. We also have an EU finance ministers meeting where finance ministers are expected to discuss coronavirus rescue fund. Now, the euro has been on a fly mode recently, perhaps due to the announcement by the EU Commission over a 750 billion euros rescue plan, and an official approval at this EU finance ministers meeting may keep the currency supported. Now, on the other hand, a failure to seal an accord over the aforementioned proposal may prompt some euro bulls to liquidate their positions and force the common currency to correct lower. Now, from the US, we get the preliminary University of Michigan Consumer Sentiment Index for June, which is expected to have risen to 75 from 72.3. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in more detailed and frequent analysis, you can find me on our YouTube channel from Tuesday to Friday at around 7:30 a.m. GMT time. So goodbye and have a nice day.
JFT, just fair and direct.